Okay, so I've started recording. As I've already said, there are parents, there are students from 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th grade. I don't know if there are any 4th graders. And I'm very happy that everyone was able to join us. The reason why we have organized this debate is to have a little bit of fun, because we have such good debaters in our school, and it would be a pity not to use them for an event like this. Most of them have been preparing day and night for the previous and the upcoming competitions. We've had incredibly good results at the Olympia local and global round, and I expect nothing less at the upcoming World Scholars Cup, which is going to take place on the 14th, 15th, and 16th of June. If we don't crush all the other teams, then why are we even doing this? All jokes aside, if you are good at debating, I would like to just mention one more thing. Debating is not related only to school activities. It is related to everyday real life. Some of the things that you are supposed to use at debating, some of the more subtle tricks, let's say, are things that you need to be able to use in a normal conversation when you're out having a cup of coffee with your friends, on a date to impress someone, or really when you want to win an argument with your parents. Because if you structure what you're trying to say in a nice, meaningful way, and if you are persuasive, then I'm sure that they will listen to you. Today's topic is going to be, as it has been already announced, social media is good for society. And let me tell you how we'll do this. We'll start this event by doing the poll. I will start the poll, and everyone will have three options to vote for: yes, no, and I don't know. Once we have finished debating, you will get the same option again, and we will compare the votes. So we'll see who was more persuasive, which team was more persuasive, and who did better. Everyone will be asked to vote, which means that everyone in the audience will have that opportunity. We are not going to do this in a traditional way, according to the scoring sheet, where people are graded according to presentation, content, and delivery, but we'll just focus on who was more persuasive. I think that I'm actually sure that I will enjoy this event immensely, because you don't always get the opportunity to debate against such good debaters. So let me start the poll. Judges teachers and students, please don't vote. So everyone else, except for the teachers who are debating and the students who are debating, everyone can vote now. And let's compare what you think initially. Can you please cast your vote? Ooh, all right, okay. And I'll write down the votes. There are a lot of people who... There should be 38 votes. So far we have 25. All right, okay. There are 9 more people who need to vote, if my math's correct. I'm not sure it is. Can everyone please vote? Just press the buttons. Okay, 6 more to go, come on. Who hasn't voted, please do so. We need the process to be transparent. Otherwise, the students might win. What will happen then? Okay, 33, all right. Okay, so let me just write this down. So far there are 22 votes for yes. That's 67% actually. So 67% of you think that social media is good for society. There are 7 votes against, which means that's 21%. And there are 4 people who don't know, and that's 12%. Okay, so I think that from the very start, the affirmative team is at an advantage. All right, which makes things even more interesting. Let me tell you more about the rules now. We are going to use a standard format. Usually, when the motion is given, every team is given 15 minutes to brainstorm ideas and to prepare. However, we've had that time before because we announced the topic this weekend and we've had time to prepare. So we'll start straight ahead. It wouldn't make any sense for you to just wait for 15 minutes. Every speaker is going to have up to 4 minutes to speak and elaborate their speech. And there will be 1 minute in between to take notes and to prepare a rebuttal. I will take the time. And when there's 30 seconds left, I will wave this perfectly made sign, which says 30 seconds left. I didn't have the time to print this out, so we'll have to do with this makeshift sign, whatever it is. There will be 4 speakers in the students team and 4 speakers in the teachers team. Are we ready to start? Who's the first speaker of the affirmative team?
I'm teacher.
Okay, Andre, are you ready? Would you like me to start the timer?
Are you going to give a countdown or when I speak, are you going to start it?
When you start speaking, I'll just start the timer.
Okay, good morning, dear audience, opponents, and teammates. I'm Andre Kalin, the first speaker of the affirmative team. Today, the topic of the debate is the internet good for society? We, as the affirmative team, strongly believe this statement is true. Today, as the first speaker, I'll be talking about how social media has grown and helped us during this pandemic. Our second speaker will be talking about communication and socializing, free and available communication, raising awareness for numerous cases like social justice and disaster management, promoting educational content, facts, campaigns, etc. Our third speaker will be talking about the education part of social media engagement, positive campaigns that are on social media, and on whole, the education that you can find on social media. And our fourth and final speaker will be talking about mental health and social media, introverts and how social media helps them, availability of social media, and I will present only one point, which the second speaker will continue talking on. It has been proven that social media has grown from 2.07 billion people in 2015 to 3.96 billion in 2020. In today's day, 53.6% of the world's population uses social media. The average usage is 2 hours and 25 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, the first speaker of the negative team has 1 minute to prepare. Okay, the first speaker is ready because I'm the first speaker of the negative team. And I'll start the timer now. Okay, so here we go. Good afternoon, dear judges, all 38 of you, dear teammates and worthy opponents. My name is Teacher Nicola, and I'm the first speaker of the negative team on the motion that social media is good for society. It's important to state that we agree with the initial points provided by the affirmative team. Social media can indeed be beneficial in all those aspects, but at what cost? More progressive thinkers will realize that, unfortunately, social media has started to control every aspect of our life. The websites and applications that were supposed to enable users to create and share content or to participate in social networking are being used to send memes and to troll people. We will try to approach this burning issue from several angles and prove that social media is actually not good for society. I will focus mostly on the deliberate misuse of social media. Our second speaker will focus on the effects on the interpersonal skills. The third speaker will point out the negative habits brought about by social media. And our fourth and final speaker will speak about the effects on the mental health. When we did statistics, when we did research preparing for the debate, we went through some statistics, and it turns out that 3 billion people, around 40% of the world's population, uses online media. And I think that one common misconception is that social media can only have a negative effect, only on children. It affects everyone. The problem with social media is that it gives room for anonymity, and anonymity gives you courage. And if you don't believe me, just go through your chat log from the last video game you played and think about whether you would say those things in someone's face. This leads me to my first argument, which is cyberbullying. Cyberbullying existed before cyberbullying, but it was only possible face-to-face. Now it's possible for people to torment and bully others online. I think that we are all aware that cyberbullying is a very common problem. And it turns out that 25% of teens worldwide are bullied. And 43% are bullied online, which means that that percentage has been doubled. So these bullies use the anonymity that social networks give them, and they use people's trust and then belittle them in front of their peers. For instance, they might take someone's photo from their mutual group, then use it to embarrass them online. You never know where the photo will end up. And these online attacks create an intimidating, threatening, hostile educational environment for the student. Not only do they disrupt the education process, but could leave deep mental scars. And how could they not result in that when someone infiltrates their mind, when someone infests their mind, when someone infects their mind? They could be trolled based on their racial, religious, or social background, or simply because someone decided that they weren't cool enough. Information and communication technology has changed rapidly over the past 20 years. I don't think that parents are able to keep pace, and there's nothing that they can do to help their children from drowning in the sea of sorrow. The other team may say that you could prevent all of that by blocking the cyberbully's social media, email, I don't know. But let's be honest, you could go live in a cave and things wouldn't change unless we all act together, which would take ages to accomplish. Of course, there are other examples of misuse of social media, but I think that this is the most apparent one. Thank you very much. Right. Okay. Good. Almost 4 minutes. The second speaker of the negative team has 2 minutes to prepare.
Two or one?
I was just checking if you were listening carefully. One. Okay, that's a minute. Who's the second speaker of the affirmative team?
I am the second speaker of the affirmative team.
David, you have up to 4 minutes. You know the rules.
Okay. Good afternoon, dear teammates, opponents, and audience. I'm David Miloševski, the second speaker of the affirmative team of the motion Social Media is Good for Society. Today I will be presenting the facts that prove very clearly that social media is predominantly good for socialization and communication. Before I start with my points, I would like to say that the opposing team might state that social media has a negative effect on our socialization and social life. We disagree. However, we do not need any Harvard or any high-level study to prove our argument, unlike the opposing team. Just by presenting the facts, it is very clear that social media is predominantly good for socialization and communication. We are all familiar with the COVID-19 situation and the limitations it has set for us and many people around the world. We also know that a lot of people are having difficulties with their mental health in these hard times. These two things are undoubtedly related and are a problem. Nowadays, you need an internet connection and a smart device to gain access to social media. And given these circumstances, social media is useful and can help a lot. So you can communicate with other people by video call, texting, without any risk. And if it weren't for social media during that quarantine, the COVID pandemic, you would feel completely isolated from humanity, and exactly that would ruin your socialization and social life, not if you were using social media. Although you could argue that you can communicate with people in real life while sticking to the measures given by the government of your country, but my question to you is, why would you even take the slightest risk? When you have social media to reduce the risk while having the similar experience. Obviously, social media has its flaws, just like any other positive thing in the world, but the good overcomes the bad by a lot. And even the fact that we are having this debate on Zoom right now proves that when used right, social media can be very practical and a beneficial tool to have. Now, moving on to my points. My first point is that with social media, you have a free and available communication no matter where you are. That can help a lot. Let me give an example. You're in a foreign country on vacation and you've lost your partner at the airport. You have internet access at the airport, so you can easily call them through a social media platform. That way, you will not get text an absurd amount of money for a quick call to find your partner. Another example is that you can chat, call, and communicate in general with someone who is in another country and far away, like family, friend, relative, you name it. My second point is that social media is a great platform for raising awareness for numerous causes like social justice and disaster management. One example is that killing of George Floyd and many other police brutality victims in the USA, as well as in other countries. Another example are the help appeals on social media from families in Macedonia during the pandemic. My third and last point is that there are a lot of ways to promote educational content, facts, and campaigns on social media. With social media, a new way of learning has been developed. Students are working together online and helping each other with no limitations whatsoever in terms of their place of living or resources. This is very useful since in some countries the educational system might be worse than in others. This way they can get educated from different sources that learn in a different way to open up new perspectives and ways of thinking on a certain topic. To summarize, I talked about how social media helps with socializing and communication during these hard times, how social media provides you with a free available communication, and how it can be useful with raising awareness for different causes as well as promoting educational content. Thank you.
Thank you very much. 3:59, wonderful timing. Okay, the second speaker of the negative team gets 1 minute to prepare now. Okay, that's a minute. So Tanka, you have up to 4 minutes.
Good afternoon, dear audience, judges, opponents, and teammates. I'm teacher Tsutanka, the second speaker of the negative team, and I'll be talking about the negative effects that social media can have on human relationships and dangerous trends circulating on social media nowadays. My opponent said that social media has made communication a lot easier and stressed, pointed out several times that it goes especially for the circumstances we're in now with the pandemic. I can't disagree with that. But easier doesn't necessarily mean better. There has been a shift in the way we communicate. Rather than face-to-face interaction, we're tending to prefer mediated communication. And not just now during the COVID pandemic, but in general, social media has been around for quite some time. It will stay here after the pandemic is over. We'd rather email than meet, we'd rather text than talk on the phone, we'd rather chat in online games than during games played outside in person. I know it's easier that way for some people, but we are losing that human touch. I saw a video the other day and remembered a line that I really liked. The guy said, iPod, iMac, iPhone, iChat, I can do all of these things without making eye contact. It's a very, very sad truth. And what are human relationships without that? We go to a restaurant, we see a family of four or five or a group of friends having lunch or dinner, and most of them are just staring down at their phones. They're either tweeting or updating their Facebook status or posting photos on Instagram, probably from the food they've just been searched, and they're basically ignoring each other. So social media is distracting us from spending quality time with our family and friends. It's like taking photos has become more important than the experience itself. So this creates a so-called fake perfection. That brings about unreal expectations. You see photos of people, amazing photos of their travels, of their perfect kids, and they're all smiling, happy. But and people want that. If they can have it, they can't help but feel disappointed, maybe even jealous. And subconsciously, we might know that not all of those pictures are real, and that people show us what they want us to see, what they want us to believe. But still, seeing what we can have, what we consider perfect, can make us feel disappointed, and again, even jealous. Social media also causes mistrust among partners. Research shows that couples who use social media excessively fight more often. Yes, it's easier to chat with people, it's easier to communicate even with strangers, but that also makes it easier to cheat. And this leads to infidelity and to breakups. Social media doesn't only hurt relationships, but also individuals themselves. I'm pretty sure most of you have heard at least some of the dangerous trends out there on social media nowadays. For example, the cinnamon challenge, where kids, people, let's say, swallow cinnamon as much as they can without drinking water. And some choke, I read that a four-year-old died doing that. Also the Tide Pods challenge, where they swallow and chew on those pods of detergent, chemicals, again, very dangerous. And I'm pretty sure everyone has heard of the Blue Whale challenge, where kids were made to do several different challenges, eventually leading them to commit suicide. So yeah, to sum up, I think that social media can have a negative effect on both human people as individuals and their relationship to other people. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The third speaker of the affirmative team has 1 minute to prepare. Okay, that's a minute. Who's the third speaker of the affirmative team?
I am, teacher.
Hi, Elena. When you start speaking, I'll just start the timer, all right?
Okay. Good afternoon, dear teammates, opponents, and audience. I am Elena Farisi, the third speaker on the affirmative team on the motion, social media is good for society. Today, I will be talking about how social media can help in education. Before I start, a quick rebuttal about the last opponent. I wanted to say that a lot of materials which are provided on social media can be false or fabricated. But however, we have a lot of sources on which we can check if the materials that are provided are legitimate. And so they can be very useful. And as we have seen this time, or however long social media has been active now, it has been so useful for everyone, especially since the pandemic showed up. Social media is about conversations, community, connecting with the audience, and building relationships. It's not just a broadcast channel or a sales and marketing tool. There are many ways of what we can use social media for. If we need to learn something new or something that we don't know, there are loads of different social media platforms from which we can learn whatever we need, such as YouTube, Facebook, Google Plus groups, and many more. The use of social media in education provides students with the ability to get more useful information, to connect with learning groups and other educational systems that make learning convenient. Students can benefit from online tutorials and resources that are shared through social networks. To summarize, I talked about how even though some of the materials could be incorrect, you can still check in the internet. I also talked about positive campaigns that are on social media, and I mentioned about social media engagement. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elena. The third speaker of the negative team gets 1 minute. Time. The third speaker of the negative team. When you start speaking, I'll just start the timer.
Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, dear judges, teammates, and worthy opponents. My name is Teacher Senada, and I'm the third speaker of the negative team on the motion social media is good for society. Before I come to my own arguments, first let us have a look at what the previous speaker said. She tried to tell you that education during these hard times of COVID-19 is really important to be conveyed through social media and online. But also that we learn something new every day or we get new information. But actually, when we look at the facts, physical education is far better than the online education that sadly we have at the moment. Also, not all information that we find on social media or online are correct. And Isn't it better when we open a book to find new information and everything that we need there? We learn better, we learn faster. Now, let's go to my arguments. First of all, social media has grown into one of the most addictive practices in the world. Why that is? Maybe you will ask, but it is really simple. The primary way that social media companies such as Facebook and Twitter make money is through advertisement. And that's why they need to draw people in. They want you to scroll for as long as possible and in order to show you a lot of ads and that way make a lot of money. So you will end up checking your Facebook or Instagram feed for maybe all day without even thinking about it or without even realizing it. By doing that, you will end up on missing the really important things in life, such as enjoying a family dinner or playing with your friends, or even fully focusing on a debate session, such as this one. The only thing you care about is, for example, how many likes your last selfie got, or how many friends you've made in the last 24 hours, whether someone has unfollowed you and stuff like that. That leads me to my second argument, which is the fear of missing out. This fear is one of the most widespread negative effects of social media on society. It has become a common theme, but it's also another reason to continually check social media sites. The idea that you might miss out on something if you're not online can affect your mental health. The fear of missing out can compel you to pick up your phone every few minutes to check for updates or even compulsively respond to every alert that you receive. Even sadly, if that means taking risks while you're driving or missing out sleep at night or even prioritizing social media interaction over real world communication. To make it clearer, in a way, it's a form of anxiety that you get when you're scared of missing out on some positive experience that somebody else might be having. For example, you might be constantly checking your messages to see whether someone messaged you and invited you out. Or if that's not the case, you might focus on your Instagram feed to make sure that nobody is doing something cool without you. And for all of this reason, I truly believe that social media is not a good thing for society. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The last speaker of the affirmative team gets a minute to prepare. I saw she was laser focused, so let's see. Okay, time. Teddy, I gave you 7 more seconds because of my witty remark. I didn't want to distract you. I apologize. Are you ready?
Yeah, I am. So right. Whenever you start talking.
Yes, please.
Yeah. All right. Good afternoon, dear teammates, opponents, and audience. I'm Teodorista Skalaskalovsky, and as the fourth speaker of the affirmative team, I will be wrapping up our side of this debate on the motion social media is good for society. I'll begin with a quick rebuttal. Do you have social media? Because I am betting you do. If it's as bad as you say, why do you use it on a daily basis? You continue to focus on the bad effects of social media instead of the good ones, and that is your choice, but there is no lie that social media is useful and predominantly good. Well, continue on to my own points, you can think about the question, the big question, and answer the big why. Now, my first point, mental health and confiding in people online. Who would you trust with your most personal information? A problem at work or home? A health scare? Friend who's falling apart? Would you go to your partner, your best friend, your mother? Maria Lewis Mull, a Harvard sociologist and an author of the 2017 book Someone to Talk To, found in his research that the answers to these questions often didn't match. People consistently said that they would trust those in their inner sanctum, but when asked whom they last shared their experience with, it was often a random person on a plane, their hairdresser, or a stranger in a waiting room. This is because our closest relationships are our most complex ones. For example, a mother has your entire life history in her head. When we need comfort, we're unsure which of the roles these people might play, and where it might be a role that gives us something other than the unconditional support we're looking for in that moment, so we're confined in someone else altogether. Social media allows for these opportunities and can be instrumental for personal development, as social media is a good outlet to let your emotions out, since there are lots of people that would gladly listen to you and your problems. But it should be used carefully, as confiding in a stranger can make us vulnerable to people and groups that can use this information that we confide them with for other not so positive uses. My second point regards social interactions. Whether it is professional or personal situations, it can be uncomfortable for introverts who sometimes feel overwhelmed when they must engage a few or many people. However, the premise that introverts dislike being around people is entirely untrue. As an introvert myself, I enjoy and seek out the company of others, even more so when I have the opportunity to pace myself during an event with more time spent in quality conversations. I often find the small talk portion of conversations deadening and relax only when a topic comes up to which I can fully relate and feel passionate about. I sometimes feel drained following an extended or intense face-to-face social interaction. I need the opportunity to briefly recharge after an exchange with another person. For those who cherish their privacy and prefer more alone than social time, space can be can give them their social time without actually having to talk to anybody. Social media can help many introverts interact from a safe place, free of noise, eye contact, or the feeling of being cornered into a conversation. Social media is a bridge that connects them to new people in ways that they're comfortable with. It is also a nice face-to-face practice for conversations that will further on happen for introverts that feel like they need it. My last point of the day before I finish up is the availability of social media. With one quick tap, you access a large framework of information about everything and anything. Imagine this. Your parents force you to go to your twice removed distant cousin's wedding, and you know no one there. You're just sitting there staring off into the abyss, bored out of your mind. And then it hits you. You take out your phone and open a social media app, that be Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat. It really doesn't matter. The first thing you see is a cool poster about an upcoming protest. You spend a few minutes signing the petition and learning more about the cause. Then add the date to the protest to your calendar. You plan to go. Next up, you check your messages, and what luck, one of your friends texted you. Guess what? They're all so incredibly bored. So you continue chatting with them, and before you know it, you're in the car driving back home. Through this scenario, I tried to explain how with accessibility of social media, you can make something fun that you actually do not find fun. As well as briefly mention everything that was talked about by my teammates in our previous arguments in a non-traditional way. I also hope that this debate was fun. And with that, I bid you goodbye, as I'm certain you will share about this debate on your social media, and thus I rest our case. Social media is good for you and good for society. I'm done.
Thank you very much, Teddy. Okay, the last speaker of the negative team gets a minute. Okay, that's a minute. Gordana?
Okay, hi everyone. Can I start?
You can start now.
Okay, perfect. So good afternoon, dear judges, teammates, and opponents. My name is Ms. Gordana, and I'm the fourth speaker of the negative team. Now, the third affirmative speaker has tried to emphasize the positive outcomes for people's mental health, especially for introverts, giving them a right format that might make them feel secure. While this might be true, the fact that introverts get drained by the constant check of feet and navigating through tabs still stands. It's pretty much how they would have felt if they were at a party. Just think about how overwhelming it is for all people, all of us, especially in this pandemic time, not only for introverts, with this intense need to check updates, messages, emails, or to keep in touch with people, and how draining it is for keeping a healthy mind balance at all. Now, in continuation to what my teammates stated, I will be referring to two points. My first point is that social media users' mental health gets heavily damaged, especially if social media is used more than 2 hours per day, as found out by a recent Canadian study. And let's all admit that we use it more than 2 hours per day. So this is food for thought. This is largely due to the constant need to feel validated and this fear of exclusion from group interactions, which is still topical for teenagers. This intensifies anxiety, causes severe nervousness, and as a US 2016 study reports, the more social media sites teenagers use, the higher the depression risk they put themselves into. Now, this leads to my second point, or that individual well-being heavily suffers too. Social media interactions, which lack positive online feedback, can easily slip people's mind into self-doubt or what is worse, self-hatred. Not to mention the countless status-seeking and attention-seeking postings we witness now more than ever, which underlie self-worthiness to be dependent on social media feedback. This brings about lower levels of resilience, lower self-kindness or even happiness, which then amounts to suicidal attempts to 48% of heavy social media users, as the Psychiatry Q Journal reports. Let me briefly restate what my points brought up by far. So our first speaker shed light on cyberbullying as the root for anonymity and how dangerous spread of misinformation is held by social media. Our second speaker talked about how our human relationships suffer because of the unreal expectations and infidelity among users. She also stated that severity of the ever-emerging dangerous trends that social media easily gives basis to. Our third speaker made it clear how addictive social media is and how all platforms use this selfishly for their own progress, especially in younger population, which led to her second point that the fear of missing out puts users at risk of compulsive use with the very dangerous consequences upon your life. Now to conclude, as one of the greatest English-American poets puts it when he's talking about modern man's mind, T.S. Eliot, he says that the modern man's mind is distracted from distraction by distraction. And we believe that this pinpoints the notion of how detrimental social media is for some key spheres of today's society. All it does is misdirect users towards disastrous practices in relation to both others and themselves. Thus, something that relies on destruction cannot ever be genuinely good for the community. Thank you.
Okay, so with that being said, we can wrap up the whole debate. Everyone has had their turn, and let's see which team was more persuasive. So let me just remind you about what the results from the first poll were. So there were 22 people who voted for yes, that was 68%. Seven people voted for no, that social media is not good for society, which is 21%. And there were four people who didn't know, which amounts to about 12% of the whole, of all the votes. Now, I'm actually going to start the debate, that would take for too long. I'm going to relaunch the poll, and I would like you to vote one more time. Think about what's been said, see which ideas you liked better, and whether you've perhaps changed your mind. Let's see. Okay, 23 people have voted so far. We need 38 people to vote. Okay, all right. Please vote. 33 people have voted. Come on, give us more votes, please. How many votes did we have before this? My math is not very good, but wait, let me see. We had 33 votes before. Now we have 34. Okay, all right. Well, I suppose then if no one's voting, I could say that these are the final results. Okay, so in the first poll, sorry, what? I didn't hear what they said, never mind. Okay, so at the first debate, there were 33 people who voted. Now we have 36 people. I hope that none of the debaters voted. That would make absolutely no sense. So the current poll votes are as follows. Can you see them, by the way? I'm not sure if you can see them on the screen.
No, teacher, I don't think if you vote, you can see them.
All right, okay, so this is these are the final votes. Like, I feel like at Eurovision now. So is social media good for society? I'll start with from the bottom. I don't know. There's only one person who doesn't know. There were four before that, which means that only 3% of the entire audience doesn't know if social media is good for society. Right. During the first results, there were seven people who voted for no, that society, social media is actually bad for the society, or is not good for society, which was 21%. Now we have 14 votes, which amounts to 38%, which is an increase of 17%. Not bad, I suppose. There are 22 people who voted yes, social media is good for society. There were 22 people in the first poll and there are 22 people now. So before that, it was 68%. Now it is 59%. So there has been a slight change. But to be honest, I'm not very good at statistics, so I'm not sure who wins. To be honest, it doesn't really matter. If someone is good at statistics, please do the math and let us know who wins. Right, I would just like to mention one thing. At an actual debate for the upcoming competitions, there will be a scoring sheet that the judges will be using. And it is mainly divided in three aspects. There's structure, there's content, and there is delivery. All of those three aspects are equally important, and they can be subdivided into many subtle nuances of the debate, like the rule of three, emotional appeal, rebuttals or prebuttals. There are a lot of things that go into debating, which means that it is something that we need to consider for next time. As promised and as advertised on our social media, I'm going to let the audience share their opinion. Is there anyone who would like to say anything about the debate? Yana. Yana would like to say something. Yana.
Well, honestly, if I would have the chance to choose a winner, I wouldn't really choose anyone because you all did amazing and it was great. But the negative team, I would say, had a lot more relatable things and facts and examples, especially towards our generation and the teens. So is my opinion.
Okay, thank you very much, Yana. Is there anyone else who wants to speak their mind on this motion? All right, I don't see any. And so it means that we did a wonderful job at elaborating all the aspects, everything that there is to say on this motion, which means that then in that case, we can end the event. So final question, asking for the final time. Is there anyone else? 3, 2, 1. No. Okay. So then let me just conclude the whole event. I have to say that the students did a wonderful job. Based on the statistics on the polls, I would say that they won. There are a lot more people who think that social media is good for society. However, it is, as Gulana said, food for thought. It is an issue which is not to be taken lightly. If you enjoyed the debate, maybe this could be motivation for you to do more research, to find more about this, so we could all become, you know, that's what everyone says, better versions of ourselves. I think that especially in the education context, in the school context, this is very important to understand. In that case, I will end the meeting now. Thank you for attending. Thank you for all the entertainment and wonderful arguments. Bye.
Okay, bye.